Okay, so we're going to have a quick quiz. Michael insists on having one because Michael likes that sort of thing, and I like Michael, so I'm going to go with him and give you a quick quiz to see if you follow along with what we've talked about. Now, this quiz is less about the details of MMIC itself than it is about the probability distribution. So I've been harping on this idea that MMIC doesn't care about your probability distribution. You should just pick the best one. So we want to make certain that you get that by giving you three problems and three probability distributions you might use, and see if you can tell us which one goes with which. Okay? So here are the three problems. The first problem is your fitness function is to maximize the number of ones. So the first thing you need to see is that we're going to assume in all of these cases that our input values x are binary strings of length n. Okay, so 0000000100010011, 111000111, whatever. There's going to be a string of ones or zeros, so they're binary digits. And the first problem, we want to maximize the number of ones that appear in that sample. Do you get that, Michael?
Yeah, that's going to be maximized by just making everything a one, right?
That's right. That's right.
Okay, but we want to think about MMIC finding that.
Right, because you don't know that that's the true underlying fitness function. That just happens to be what it is.
I see. Okay,
good. Okay. So in the second problem, we want you to maximize the number of alternations between bits. So 0101010101 is better than all ones. Much better than all ones, in fact, because the fitness you would get for maximize alternations between 0101001 is in fact n minus 1, which is the largest that could be. But if you had all the digits being the same, your fitness would be 0. You see that, Michael?
N minus one. Oh, I see. N minus one because it switch every time it switches.
Right.
Got it.
So what would maximize the number of alterations in, say, a 5-digit string?
Like 0101010.
Or
The complement of that, 10101.
Right, so two values both act as maxima here. Okay, the third problem is you want to minimize two color errors in a graph. Now that one's a little bit harder to describe, so I'm gonna draw a little graph for you. So the two color problem, you might remember, is given a graph with some edges, like say this graph here, you want to assign a color to each node such that every node has a different color than its neighbor. Okay, so we assume there's only two colors here, one and zero. So let's say I assign this the color value of one, this the color value of zero, this the color value of zero, this the color value of one, and this the color value of one. So how many errors are there, Michael?
Wait, we should be trying to maximize. But okay, so I guess not. So minimize two color errors. So an error would, in this case, would be an edge that has the same color on both ends, and I see one of those, the bottom sort of rightish.
Right. So here, these do not match, so that's good. These do not match, these do not match, but these two match, even though that one doesn't. So there's exactly one error. So in these first two examples, we're trying to maximize a fitness. Here, we're trying to minimize a cost just to make things slightly more difficult for you. If we removed this edge here, then you'll notice that this has no mismatches whatsoever, and this would be an optimum.
Got it.
Okay? So we need to figure this out. Okay, so there we go. We want you to maximize the number of ones in your string, or maximize the alternations by adjacent bits, or to minimize the number of two color errors in a graph. All right, those are the three problems. Now, here are the three distributions. The first distribution, these are in alphabetical order, is a chain. So a chain would be in kind of Bayesian network speak, a chain would be a graph like this, where basically every feature depends upon its previous neighbor. So in a 4-bit string, I'm saying that the first bit depends on nothing, the second bit depends on the value of the first bit, the third bit depends on the value of the second bit, and the fourth bit depends on the value of the third bit. So the way you would generate samples is you would generate a sample from here, and then generate a sample on here dependent upon this value. Given that value, you generate a sample here, given that value, and you generate a sample here, given that value. Got it, Michael?
I think so. So, and we're imagining that the ordering is given so we know which ones depend on which.
Right. So in fact, it's not just a chain, it's a specific chain.
And is it the same chain as, say, the ordering of the bits?
Yes, in this
Got it.
particular case. It's the same chain as the ordering of the bits. So I'm going to call this that chain.
All right.
Okay. The second one is what we've been talking about all along. It's a dependency tree. Unlike in the case with this chain here, where I'm giving you a specific chain, this is the first bit, the second bit, the third bit, the fourth bit, and so on to the nth bit. I don't know which dependency tree is here. You'd have to find it, but there's some dependency tree I want you to represent. And the third one is the easiest one to think about, and that's where everything is independent of everything else. So if I were to draw that, it would be a bunch of nodes with no edges between them, directed or otherwise. And so the joint probability across all your features is just the product of the unconditional probabilities. Sort of the simplest probability distribution you can have. Okay, you got that, Michael?
Yeah, so, and, okay, if I'm understanding correctly, each of these is actually representable by a dependency tree.
Yeah, each one is, actually.
So then why would anyone be better than any other one?
I don't know, Michael, you tell me.
I guess in the case of, well, it could be, you could think of it in, maybe in terms of the number of parameters that need to be estimated. So in the independent case, since we know that it's independent, or at least we're imagining it's independent, we just have to estimate one probability per node, which is like n.
Yep.
In the chain case, we have a conditional probability per node, so it's like 2n parameters.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And in the dependency tree case, it's, I think what you were saying is that we're estimating kind of n squared parameters and then pulling the tree out of that.
Exactly. Now, of course, like you point out, Michael, each of the, a chain is a dependency tree. Independents are a dependency tree, and a dependency tree is, surprisingly enough, a dependency tree. But these numbers of parameters do matter, because although a dependency tree can represent an independent set of variables, the way you're going to discover that they're independent is you're going to need a lot of data to estimate those n squared parameters in order to realize that the conditional probability tables effectively don't mean anything. So it would be very easy for a dependency tree to overfit in the case where all the variables or all the features are actually independent.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So you got it?
All right. Nope. Not one more question.
Yes.
Well, other than what, and I need to fill the boxes in with the numbers 1, 2, or 3, right?
Yep. Of
and
the algorithm that they're best for. Or the problem, they're best for.
Got it. And each one is used exactly once?
Yes.
Okay. And then finally, just to kind of make sure that I'm wrapped my head around why we're doing probability distributions at all. So in the context of MMIC, we need some way of capturing the space of answers that do at least a certain level. They do at least this well in terms of the fitness. So I feel a little thrown off because we're not trying to represent the fitness functions, right? You're not telling me which dependency structure should I be using to represent this fitness function.
Right. Instead, I'm asking you to figure out which distribution will represent the optima, the structure between the optimal values.
Okay. All right. I'm not sure I 100% get it, but I think I get it enough to answer this quiz.
Excellent. Okay. So go.